funeral service for humble leader Sir Manasupe Zurenuoc. 6 people still missing at sea after 9 days. Lae City Dwellers win first OFC match.
This is National MTV News with Mereba Tolo.
A very good evening. Thank you for joining us for Saturday's news. 6 people are missing at sea. They were last seen on Thursday, the 2nd of March. A relative of 2 of the missing people told MTV News that the 6 had left Wewak for Manus on Thursday, the 2nd of March. They were supposed to return on Friday, but failed to do so.
Jane Kutau, Sarah Kutau, Jimmy Markamet, and Shane Markamet, along with 2 others from Tawari Island, East Sepik Province, left Wewak on Thursday, 2nd of March, on a 23-foot banana boat with 240-horsepower engines for Manus. Brother of Jimmy and Shane, Cosmos Markamet, told MTV they had arrived in Manus. They were carrying betel nut to sell in Manus because of the high demand. They were on their way back when Jimmy, the skipper, called a relative and told them that one of the 40-horsepower engine was facing problems. That was the last they heard from the 6. When the boat did not arrive in Wewak the next day, they reported the matter to Wewak Disaster Office. Maritime Rescue Coordination Center sent out a radio call to all vessels in and around the coordinated area to look out for the missing boat. However, to date, there is no sight of the boat or of its passengers. Cosmos Markamet said that even though it has been a week since they were missing, they are hopeful the 6 may still be alive. Adelaide Sirox Kari, National MTV News.
The Judicial Services in Papua New Guinea continues to expand its services to provincial towns. Yesterday, it elevated West New Britain Province to a sub-regional court location. This means West New Britain is one step away from becoming a full court location like Kokopo in East New Britain, Lae in Morobe, and Mount Hagen in Western Highlands.
The elevation comes following the swearing-in of the second residential judge for Kimbe and the commissioning of the Kimbe National Court Complex. The elevation is in line with Chief Justice Sesalamo Injia's vision to establish and improve judicial services at provincial and district levels. Speaking during the commissioning event, Sesalamo explained that national courts must be expanded to accommodate the increase in court cases and minimize the time frame that court takes to complete proceedings. Sesalamo said without proper court facilities, a judge will not be able to hear cases.
The government gives us a very small slice of the cake, national budget. So we in the judiciary, we have strong, strict fiscal discipline.
The new Kimbe Court Complex was officially opened by the Chief Justice in the presence of the residential judges and the Chief Magistrate. It houses the judges' chambers and a renovated national courtroom. Inside the chambers, there is a little lounge area, the judges' workstation and shower room and kitchen facilities. It was built with support from the provincial government at a cost of 700,000 kina. Those who attended the commissioning were given the opportunity to enter the chambers and the new courtroom.
In the third arm of the government, that we expand the services to all parts of the country.
I also join our Chief Justice. He has given a lot of importance on the quality of building which from where we operate.
Apart from the Kimbe National Court, West New Britain has Talasia National Court, and it will be building a national court facility in Biala. Tekle Gunga, National MTV News, Kimbe.
Acting Judge Justice Nicholas Miviri has been sworn in as the second residential judge for West New Britain Province. Justice Miviri was appointed for a 12-month term as an acting judge in January this year by the Judicial and Legal Services Commission. He joins first the residential judge of West New Britain, Justice Elenas Batari.
Justice Miviri was given a traditional West New Britain welcome yesterday by a number of church choir groups in Kimbe. He was officially sworn in as the second residential judge following a dedication prayer by Bishop of the United Church in West New Britain, Reverend Gabriel Samoa.
Sitting on my left in gown is our new second judge that will be joining me here in Kimbe. So the occasion is to welcome him.
Justice Miviri comes from the Malalawa district in the Gulf province. Miviri was the director of the Royal Papua New Guinea Constabulary's legal services prior to his appointment. He has over 30 years of experience in practicing criminal and administrative laws.
If the case law requires one judge, we will put one judge. If the case law requires two judges, we'll put two judges. Case law requires three, we'll put three in a province. The maximum number of judges we put in a province is three.
The transfer of a national and Supreme Court judge can only be approved by the Chief Justice. In the past, all judges live in Port Moresby and travel to other provinces for court circuits. However, that was seen as an expensive exercise and court cases kept piling up. In 1994, the Judicial and Legal Services introduced the residential judges concept. Under this concept, judges were posted to serve in provinces.
The judiciary in the last 10 years, I should say, has been implementing a program for expansion of the judiciary service, particularly the high courts, the Supreme Court and the National Court, to the provinces.
Justice Miviri is expected to start hearing cases in the coming weeks. Thekla Gunga, National MTV News, Kimbe.
National MTV News continues after the break. Stay with us. Welcome back to the news. The National Health Department has come out in the media saying the department is aware of the cancer problem and has a plan in place to address it. Health Secretary Pasco Kase says for now there are other options for treatment available to treat cancer patients. But he says most people go to the hospital at the very late stages, making it impossible for cure.
Kase is encouraging the people to consult a doctor as early as possible if they are suspecting that something is wrong with their body.
That we would encourage people to see their doctors as early as possible if they are suspecting that something is not correct in their body, so that corrective measures can be taken to save you.
And that's he says the radiation treatment at the PNG cancer facility is old, but the department has plans to obtain new machines. For now, PNG needs to have proper laws in place before new equipment can be bought.
So I would like to people to bear with the health department that in order for us to bring in this kind of equipment, because it involves radioactive substances, we need to have proper laws in place to allow us to have.
Kase said the health minister, Michael Malabag, will be taking a submission to cabinet to approve a new law on radiation safety in PNG.
Submission to cabinet to approve a new law on radiation safety in Papua New Guinea, how we manage it, how we import it, and how we maintain it in our country. So it's not that easy. Like
the health secretary's comments come after the recent public outcry over the limited attention given to the PNG cancer facility. 4 days ago, Michael Daure, an advocate on cancer awareness, called on the national government to focus its attention on the PNG cancer center.
Missing out strong government is you may need to buy more machines, you may need to buy more radiotherapy machines, especially one time all one kind machines when necessary lo down him eliminate him cancer into the Papua New Guinea.
Daure also expressed his concern on the need for more awareness to be carried out, especially in the rural areas, as most people are not aware of the signs and symptoms relating to cancer so that they can go for testing. Mata Luis, National MTV News, Lae.
A ward councillor in Lae says more Papua New Guinean girls must be encouraged to enter into a broad range of careers and be involved in decision-making. Carol Yawing, the only woman in the Lae urban local level government, said parents must take the education of girls seriously. Her comments come days after PNG celebrated International Women's Day with the rest of the world.
Women and girls have the potential to be exposed to a range of careers. The councillor for Ward 2 of Lae Urban, Carol Yawing, said more women and girls should have access to relevant education and training. This can better improve the living standard of households, especially in the rural areas.
I mean, no got more poret or banis or boundary or one them all by go more yet me abrusimi tuna ego more yet.
Yawing's comments come days after PNG celebrated International Women's Day and the visit of Australian Foreign Affairs Minister Julie Bishop, whose visit also drew attention to the needs of women and girls in PNG. Grace Lima is a women's representative in Bundi Camp. She sees the difficulties of women firsthand. In the past, there were a lot more barriers and boundaries preventing girls from being educated. Lima said women and girls should work together in a positive manner to bring about changes in their homes and communities.
Na mi en kadje mo likli kol meri na ol staplo school inside lo ward here ablomi. Go lo school take education seriously. Na no can look back lo our community stop na yumi la o kata kama po se one kind ta sol na stop. No god, yumi must break through. Na kama sample kind ol pikini ni lo behind time.
Gender equality is a way forward for women and girls to gain equal opportunities as men. Councillor Yawing said with the experience gained during a term in office, she is confident that other women can do the same. Julie Badui Owa, National MTV News, Lae.
This week in Lae, Australian Foreign Minister Julie Bishop visited the National Agriculture Research Institute, where a series of Australian government-funded projects are being rolled out. One of the projects is a solar-powered rice mill program supported by Trukai Industries. Again, Julie Badui Owa with this report.
80 units of these solar-powered rice mills will be distributed to 30 communities in Morobe province to boost food security and sustainability in the rural areas. The Australian government is supporting this program through the PNG Women in Agriculture organization. Apart from milling rice grown locally, the solar-powered machine can also help rural farmers improve their standard of living.
With these units comes a light, LED lighting packs and charging packs so that they can have light at the village at night time, and they can also have power to charge their mobile phones so that they can improve their communication.
The solar-powered rice mill eliminates the use of diesel engine mills. This machine will now help farmers save transport costs when travelling to urban areas to mill their rice.
Of course, this is an ongoing expense, so we thought, well, how can we use this technology to help people at village level using renewable energy, which has no cost and helps them not only mill their rice that they're growing locally, which then helps them with their food security and sustainability.
Each unit come in different sizes. The machine launched today cost 15,000 kina. Trukai Industries is engaged with large-scale rice development, including this project, which falls under Trukai's Village Sustainability Program.
Yeah. Maybe not everywhere in Papua New Guinea you can grow rice in large scale. So then it's about how do we support villages to improve life and well-being, health and wellness in the rural sector. And this is a great example of bringing that to a reality for Papua New Guinea.
Julie Badui Owa, National MTV News, Lae.
A school in the Gulf province is raising funds to build a brand new science laboratory. The Kerama Coronation Secondary School hosted a corporate dinner this week in Port Moresby. Elites from the province were invited to attend and were given the opportunity to contribute towards this worthy cause.
The corporate dinner held for the Kerama Coronation Secondary School aimed to raise 800,000 kina on the evening. Several distinguished people attended, in the likes of former Governor Chris Haiveta, Higher Education Secretary Professor David Kavanamur, and women leaders Susan Setai and Janet Sape.
We're starting with our priority number one need, the science lab. Hence, thank you very much everybody here for making that start with us.
The school has seen improvements in recent times after years of neglect. This year, the school will graduate its pioneer grade 12 students.
If we are giving only theory lessons to our students with a science subject. We must give them practical as well.
The school has 663 students in total, and the school wants to ensure that those taking chemistry, physics and biology subjects have access to the practical aspects of their education.
School does not have a proper science laboratory, which is a really big problem for us, the students taking science courses like biology, physics, and chemistry.
The principal said the Parents and Citizens Association has agreed to pay 425 kina for day students and 550 kina for boarding students to address some of the school's urgent issues. Deli Waigeno, National, MTV News.
Two missionaries from Israel are in the country to spread the word of God. The pair will host a three-day conference in Lae tomorrow, followed by another four-day conference in Port Moresby.
Archbishop Dr. Dominic Byman, accompanied by her husband Rabbi Baruch, arrived on PX600 at the Jackson's International Airport and were welcomed by the Christian friends and families. Israel's first Jewish woman archbishop will conduct a conference in Lae from 12th to 14th of March and in Port Moresby from the 15th to 18th of March. Archbishop Dr. Dominic has mentored many Papua New Guineans on their visit to Israel. Her ministry, the Global Revival Messianic Bible School, celebrates the Feast of Tabernacle in Israel yearly.
Shalom, Papua New Guinea. Me liking you very much. And me wanting you to come to the conference, I want to see all of you. Come to the conference, your life will be completely changed.
Archbishop Dr. Dominic is inviting the public to attend a conference in Lae and in Port Moresby.
We have come all the way, almost 3 days, to be able to get to you. And I'm looking forward to see you here. Hallelujah, at the start and throughout the conference. Come even with a notebook on you, with a pen. Come ready to learn. There is something I know about you, Papua New Guinea, just sincere people. And you mean business with God. And I know that you want truth and you're going to have it download. We love you. Shalom and Shabbat Shalom.
Jason Dome, National MTV News.
This next story is a glimpse into the life of Benson Wane, a 24-year-old security guard from the Southern Highlands province. Benson became a security guard to support his mother after his abusive father walked out on them when he was still in high school. He says his father abused him during his high school days. Bethany Herrmann with this report.
It's a long day's work for a static guard. The pay is barely legal. It's monotonous and can at times be dangerous work. But for those who are on the job, it's a lifeline. Benson Wane is a security guard for a respected company that does look after its guards. He agreed to speak to us about his life. While now just 24, Benson has already gone through his fair share of life's hard knocks.
2013,
He dropped out of school after grade 10 when his father walked out on him and his mother. He is now looking after his mother with the money he makes as a security guard.
At the same time, I'm living in Kalamospina, and I'm living in Normano. Look out to me. I'm not a meat and bread, and I'm going to look at my mom again. Look at my life and mad now because I'm not going to school or something, but no, I can't get out of school.
Many Papua New Guineans can relate to Benson's story. It's about a person who sacrificed education and is now on minimum wage. For 350 kina a fortnight, Benson's struggle is as real as it gets, as he continues to support his mother while focusing on improving his future. Benson's story gives a glimpse into the realities faced by ordinary Papua New Guineans. Most don't speak up because they are too busy, barely making ends meet. Bethany Harriman, National MTV News.
You're watching National MTV News. When we come back, story making headlines overseas, as well as the farewell of former Chief Secretary to Government, Sir Manasupe Zurenuoc, in Lae. Stay with us. Welcome back to National MTV News. Turning overseas now, and gunmen stormed a major military hospital in Afghanistan, killing at least 30 people and dozens more wounded. It happened at a heavily fortified diplomatic quarter in Kabul that is close to the U.S. embassy. Security forces killed the attackers after a six-hour standoff.
A brazen attack that began at 9 o'clock this morning. This, the Sadar Mohammed Dawa Khan Hospital, is a stone's throw from the gate of the U.S. embassy compound, what should be, frankly, one of the most secure parts of the capital. It's absolutely at the heart of the Afghan military infrastructure here, but it was at that 9 o'clock time this morning that four men approached the southern gate. One was a suicide bomber. They were all disguised as medical personnel, and the other three managed to get inside and fanned out across the multi-story building, we understand. Horrifying pictures showing patients cowering on the balconies outside their hospital rooms to perhaps escape these attackers. Afghan commandos landing on the roof. It was then, I think, that they began this awful 6.5 hour task of trying to keep those attackers away from the multitude of patients and doctors inside the hospital. Although, unfortunately, it seems by the end of the day, at least 30 people lost their lives. That includes doctors, patients and medical personnel, and 50 were injured. The Taliban, you would normally think to point the finger at for an attack like this, brazen as it was, but instead they denied responsibility quickly on Twitter, perhaps trying to keep some distance from a brazen attack on medical infrastructure like that, perhaps against the laws of wars. In fact, called by the American commander in Afghanistan, General Nicholson, an unspeakable crime. Instead, quickly stepped forward ISIS and their Iraq-affiliated news agency saying that, quote, their commandos were behind this attack. It comes at a very bad time for Afghanistan. We say that often, but this is a key summer ahead here and a time of record casualties for Afghan security forces. Their military and police between January and November of last year alone lost over 6,000 men. That's deaths. 11,000 were injured. Staggering figures, and also perhaps underpinned by figures too from the US Inspectorate for Afghanistan, who say that just over half the country is in fact controlled by the government, a third contested with the Taliban, and the Taliban perhaps control about a tenth of it. These are chilling numbers indeed. They'll weigh upon the Trump White House as they try and work out what their next policy move should be in this America's longest war. None of that, though, will assuage the loss of those inside Kabul today who thought they were safe inside this hospital, but instead found themselves under 6 hours of what appears to be an ISIS attack.
On to some good news now, and two young boys in America have provided a valuable lesson in relations. The best friends, one black, one white, wanted to fool their teacher by getting the same haircut. Now their matching buzz cuts and unbreakable bond are touching hearts around the world.
Two pint-sized peas in a pod.
How long have you two boys known each other?
400 years. Not true.
Jax Rosebush on the right, Reddy Weldon on the left. And their five-year-old hijinks is all the buzz. It started here in the barber's chair.
I said, you need your haircut, and he said, well, I'm not getting a haircut unless I can get it cut like Reddy's.
That's because the boys wanted to play a trick. Jack's mom posted on Facebook, he said he couldn't wait to go to school so that his teacher wouldn't be able to tell them apart.
Who came up with that idea?
Crayons?
At the Christian Academy of Louisville, Miss April played right along, even switching the boys' cots at nap time.
They were so excited, and they wanted to trick me and trick their friends, so, you know, I had to play along.
Reddy and his brother were orphans from the Congo, adopted as babies.
He knows that he doesn't look exactly like Daddy. We teach that's a very valuable thing. Adoption's something to be celebrated. Diversity's something to be celebrated.
Fuzz my head. Uh-huh. Do my hair. Fuzzy.
It's got a good feel to it.
And what do the moms and dads think of the haircut scene round the world?
It doesn't matter what somebody looks like on the outside, it's what's on the inside that matters.
Maybe we have it all wrong and we should listen to the kids a little more.
We play more and we love each other.
For this inseparable pair, friendship is a bond that transcends all.
2 years ago, an American couple was trying to raise money to adopt a child from China. Their story was aired on CNN, and 8 hours later, the Wilsons had the $30,000 they needed. And now, 2 years on, the boy who goes by the name Jason is adapting to life in the U.S.
The most popular student at recess in Grain Valley, Missouri, doesn't jump the highest or run the fastest. Jason Wilson can't jump or run. He can make people feel inspired. I met Jason 2 summers ago at this orphanage in China. Back then, he went by Zha Zha. He was like a big brother to all the other orphans.
It's okay.
He was desperate for a family of his own. Brian and Jerry Wilson had been trying for months to raise $30,000 in adoption fees.
It was amazing.
They reached their goal in 8 hours when we told their story on CNN.
A lot of spoilers.
I was with the Wilsons when they traveled to China to take their son home.
A little nervous.
1 year later, I'm in Missouri for the first time since his adoption.
Hello. Hi, Jason.
He chose his new name because he says it's cool.
You're so big.
Jason's 10 now, growing up almost as quickly as he's learning.
T-R-U-S-T.
Reading and writing is a challenge.
A dog called German Shepherd.
But he is quickly catching up.
Is he popular with the other kids?
Absolutely. They all are giving him high fives all the time, and he fits right in, especially at recess.
Oh my gosh.
Jason has become a star at Snyabar Elementary. Teachers say his personality is magnetic.
It's just the way that he approaches his life, and he doesn't see it as a life with challenges.
What's your favorite sport to play?
Football.
Why?
Because it's cool.
Jason's learning music, singing in school concerts, in the cafeteria.
Hi, I haven't seen you in a long time.
He always has plenty of friends to sit and sing with.
Delaware, Florida, Georgia, Hawaii.
You'd never know Jason grew up more than 6,000 miles away. He chooses not to speak Chinese anymore.
He never wants to talk about China. He never wants people to know he's Chinese.
Jason's English teacher says he does love talking about his family.
It's everything to him. He talks about his sisters all the time. He talks about dad, and they play football.
Despite Jason's success, the Wilsons have struggled in the last year.
We have more of an issue than what we thought. So.
An expensive construction snag stopped work on their new accessible house. And there's family turmoil, including serious health problems with Jason's grandparents. The Wilsons thought they were saving him, but Jason also saved them.
We can get through this because, you know, he's had to struggle and get through this.
Doctors told the Wilsons Jason will probably never walk, the result of botched spina bifida surgery in China.
Wow.
So they raised the money to buy him a stander, allowing greater mobility than ever before. He's also been reunited with his best friend Jeremiah from the orphanage, adopted by another family in their church. Each day brings new challenges and new victories.
What's different now?
Having love. I think.
Having love.
Mm-hmm. Ready? Touch it. Oh!
After a childhood spent waiting and hoping, Jason finally has the one thing he always dreamed about. A family.
I know.
Back home now, and the Prime Minister, Peter O'Neill, and Governor General Bob Dadai today paid their final respects to an exemplary Moorabbian, Sir Manasupe Zurenuoc. They were among other dignitaries who travelled to Lae for the former Chief Secretary's funeral. The Prime Minister described him as a humble leader who played an important part in shaping the country. Sir Manasupe passed away early last week at his home.
At the St. Paul's Church this morning, those who knew Sir Manasupe Zurenuoc gathered in numbers. Inside, the pews were filled to capacity. Those who couldn't find a seat stood outside. Earlier, Morbihan leaders arrived to pay their respects. Tewai Siasi MP Mao Zeming, Nawai's Gisuat Siniwin, and the governors of Morobe, Hela, and the Southern Highlands. Prime Minister Peter O'Neill arrived, and a few minutes later, the Governor General Bob Dadai. Retired servicemen from Igam led the procession that brought the casket into the church. The casket carried by soldiers in honor of a man who gave his life to the service of the people. A lot of achievements by a man who lived for only 56 years. For much of his life, he served Morobe as an administrator and a lawyer. Morobe Governor Kelly Naru said the public service was a profession he chose deliberately.
In his capacity, he has, to my mind, fulfilled what he was sent to fulfill.
And yes, there was mourning, but as Sir Manasupe's younger sister Finkewe said earlier, the gatherings are also a celebration of his brilliant life. For his contributions to the government and the country, the Prime Minister put things into perspective.
Despite global economic conditions, as Chief Secretary, he further restructured the service delivery system of government, so that reducing the cost of running governments in our country. Sir Manasupe's priority was to ensure that the welfare of our people, welfare of his staff, working conditions throughout the country were improved at all times.
Sir Manasupe was instrumental in designing the government's tuition fee-free policy, the free healthcare policy, the creation of district authorities, Vision 2050, and the creation of Hela and Jiwaka as provinces. For Morobe during his term as administrator, Morobe province led the way in developing important disaster management processes and procedures. He also pushed for the use of concrete roads for Lae City.
His son Zure Makali said it would have been an injustice not to have mentioned how much growing up in the Eastern Highlands had influenced his dad's life. Being the son of a teacher, his rural upbringing also influenced his professional life. And apart from a brilliant memory, Sir Manasupe could recall just by facial features where a person came from and from which LLG.
As Morobe and the country celebrate the life of Manasupe Zurenuoc, many who are following in his footsteps will continue to be inspired by this humble, larger-than-life character who showed how public servants should live and serve the people. Scott Wide, National MTV News, Lae.
Trukai Sports is next. Lae City Dwellers win their first OFC match against Vanuatu, and Jonathan Thurston does it again for the North Queensland Cowboys.
Trukai Sports.
Welcome to Trukai Sports. We begin in the NRL, and it was another thrilling encounter between rivals North Queensland Cowboys and the Brisbane Broncos last night at Suncorp Stadium. Star halfback Jonathan Thurston led his team to another thrilling 21-20 victory after a drop goal in the second half of extra time.
Another one towards the post. It's Taumalolo. Look at him get up and try and play this quickly.
Thurston made no mistake when he stepped up in the 88th minute to bring the crowd to their feet. He made sure he got the kick right after his sloppy field goal attempt last week against the Raiders. Thurston broke Broncos fans' hearts again, just like he did in the unforgettable 2015 Grand Final.
You are a genius.
Broncos were the first to score through James Roberts off a Ben Hunt grabber into the in-goal area.
James Roberts scores!
Cowboys replied with a try after a strong run from Cohen Hess, carrying three Broncos players over the line. Thurston's conversion kick would see him added to the 2,000 points club.
There's 2,000 for Thurston.
A penalty was then awarded to the Broncos a few minutes later after Hunt's 40-20 kick. Milford, without a hitch, sent the ball through the posts to lead 8-6. Broncos captain Darius Boyd crossed over for his first off of a Hunt grabber kick again. The Cowboys would reply with a try from Morgan to narrow the scoreline 14-12 before halftime. In the second half, Cowboys scored early to feather their lead. Broncos then returned and crossed over the line through Jordan Kahu. A missed conversion kick from Milford would see the scores at 18-all. Sloppy football from the Broncos would see them penalized in their territory. Cowboys decide to kick to put them 2 points in front.
So first and sends it over and gives the Cowboys...
On Broncos conceded a penalty in the Cowboys 20-meter and decided to level up the score at 20-all with a conversion from Milford. As the game headed into extra time, many drop goal attempts were shut down by both teams. Till the 88th minute, after a strong run from Taumalolo, who set up a clear shot for Thurston, who sent the ball flying through the posts. Elijah Levette, National, MTV Sports.
The East Tigers arrived in Port Moresby today ahead of the Interest Super Cup clash against the SP Hunters. It was a quiet welcome for the Tigers, with some new faces travelling to PNG for the first time. Amongst the team was former Kumul Tommy Butterfield, who captained the team last year when they played the Hunters for the first time at the National Football Stadium. They had the captain's run this afternoon and final preparations before tomorrow's match against the Hunters. The match kicks off at 3 p.m. 40 teams in the Moresby South electorate came together on Friday to battle for the JT Cup 2017. Tournament director Bagelo Solian said the winning team from the three-day competition will not only take home the cup, but 20,000 kina as well.
Great talent was showcased in Moresby South as 40 participating teams took to the field with countless techniques, going head-to-head to battle for the Tchenko Cup and 20,000 kina. Tournament director Bagelo Solian said this is the first time he has seen teams come in their numbers.
The event is basically our pre-season nines. Last year we had just our clubs alone, but this year we decided to open it up a bit and make it more of a challenge. So we've got 40 teams, about 34 teams from Moresby South and 6 from outside the electorate.
Solian said most of the players taking part in the tournament are from the intercity competition.
We started off with our development last week Sunday, which was an under-20s tournament, and we decided to do a development type thing. Get a lot of people involved, and the more people play in the rugby league, the better for enhancing the skill level of the game. Yeah.
The tournament was sponsored by Sports Minister Justin Tchenko with 50,000 kina.
The development program, this year we're emphasizing more on player development. You know, we tend to look at the seniors and forget that the development programs make a better senior standard of football. So we're emphasizing more and concentrating on that. We also looking to upskill our referees and coaches this year.
The competition end on Sunday with the winner to take home the Tchenko Cup and 20,000 kina prize money. Godwin Erki, National, MTV Sports.
And the tournament concluded its elimination rounds today. Of the 40 teams that took part in the competition, 16 have made it to the finals. The MTV crew arrived in time for the last match of the day and witnessed the Talai Spartans defeating KH Nokondi 10-6. Currently holding the top three spots on the ladder are Rovanama, followed by Raiders and Mahuru Eagles. The ever-popular Aroma Coast team, unfortunately, did not make it to the top three, but they are still in the running on fifth spot, followed by Pari Magpies. Calgary Oval is expected to be jam-packed tomorrow for the grand final showdown. PNG's Lae City Dwellers have opened their first OFC Champions League campaign with a thrilling 5-2 win over Vanuatu's Malampa Revivers. Dwellers coach Peter Gonemba said he was quite pleased with his team's performance and is looking forward to their second match against Auckland City next week.
A player trying to run in behind your back four.
Lae City Dwellers were on attacking mode right from kickoff, pushing into Malampa Revivers half through running forwards Obed Bika and Peter Debinyaba Jr. The quick counter-attack from Dwellers in the first 8 minutes of the game resulted in skipper Raymond Gnemba opening the scoring with a superb strike.
Got the better of Ishmael Sam and Nuriel Maliu and just rolled it into an empty net. That was on eight.
Revivers, however, responded with numerous runs into Dwellers' territory, stretching Dwellers' defense and keeping goalkeeper Ronald Warrison on high alert.
Oh, and this is a very good chance. Valentine Nelson across to help out.
Lae City soon responded. Peter Debinyaba Jr. capitalizing on Revivers' weak defense, charges past Ismail Sam and fired home his side's second.
Looked like a penalty, but it might not matter.
The celebrations would be short-lived as Revivers narrowed the gap in the 45th minute when Ronald Warrison knocks the ball into his own goal after attempting to save a corner from John Alec.
It's an own goal.
Dwellers will regroup in the second half with continuous charge down by Gunemba, and George Debenham proved menacing for the opponent's defense. Debenham's effort was rewarded by a cross from Raymond Gunemba minutes into the second half.
Goodness me! George Debenham!
Debenham was on assisting role again, sending Obed Bika through to extend Dwellers' lead.
Oh, and it's another goal! And it's Obed Bika!
A miscued clearance by Lae City Dwellers' backline saw Revivers Edwin Bai keeping his side in contention.
The comeback opportunity was presenting itself to Ishmael Edward, but he just... Well, his ball ended up in the back of the net somehow.
But that goal would be too little too late for the OFC debutants, as Lae City Dwellers stamped their authority, adding two more goals to seal the match with a four-goal advantage.
Quite amazing, Alex Kamen.
Shane Saroya, National MTV Sports.
Trukai Sports continues after the break. Don't go anywhere.
Trukai Sports.
Welcome back to Trukai Sports. In international football, Russia and FIFA officials on Thursday marked 100 days to the kickoff of the 2017 Confederations Cup. Soccer players and guests took part in celebrations at the St. Petersburg Zenit Arena Stadium, where an emblem for the soccer tournament was unveiled.
Former Brazilian defender and FIFA Confederations Cup winner Cafu was there to display the trophy for the games, which kick off on June the 17th. Russian national team midfielder Alexei Smertin and Cafu performed ball tricks, while Russian mascot Zabivaka Wolf posed for photographs. FIFA Secretary General Fatma Samoura said she was confident the games would attract fans from across Russia and abroad. Asked about Russia hosting the games, Samoura said a fair bidding process had taken place.
Take away the World Cup from Russia, and today's events demonstrate how strongly committed the authorities and FIFA and the football fans are towards staging the best Confederation Cup and the best World Cup ever.
Russia's bid for the 2018 World Cup came under scrutiny in 2015 after an FBI investigation into bribery and corruption at FIFA. The country has denied any wrongdoing. The chief executive officer for 2017 Confederations Cup and 2018 World Cup in Russia, Alexei Sorokin, said the sporting world had welcomed Russia's hosting of the games.
Не раз выраженные и футбольными звездами, и тренерами, и просто людьми с безупречной репутацией в футболе отношение к организации чемпионата мира и Кубка Федерации в России.
Zenit Arena in St. Petersburg is scheduled to host the opening match of the tournament, where Russia will play against New Zealand. The construction of the 68,000-seat stadium in St. Petersburg experienced problems since its beginning in 2007. Jeremy Moggi, National TV Sports.
The NCD Corporate Volleyball Competition had its preliminary finals today at Ella Beach. MTV Sports caught up with the men's B-grade match between NAC and Digicel, as well as the women's A-grade match between NCD and Dulux.
In the women's match, Team NCD proved too good for the Dulux side with a 3-0 victory. The first set saw a lot of avoidable mistakes from the Dulux side that saw them trailing by 10 points when NCD was already on 18. A few minutes later, the yellow-clad NCD team concluded the set 25-19. NCD then went on to replicate their opening performance with another 25-19 win to claim the second set. By the final set, efforts from a tired Dulux side went begging as the yellow team trashed them 25-11 and won the set with 3-0. In the men's B-grade match, it was a close but challenging match for Team Digicel. Though the first set was a tight one that saw both Digicel and NAC going head-to-head, every score was countered by another. A set-ending missed spike from the Digicel guys saw the NAC team to victory with 28-26. That was a refreshing win for NAC as they continued on to the last set. Digicel was on the toes this time with a couple of spikes that landed them at 19 to NAC's 21. But the blue team came prepared. Minutes later, they secured a set with a 25-23 win. Efforts to recuperate in the last set went to no avail for the Digicel side as NAC came on too strong with a 25-20 win again. The competition will head into finals next weekend, and the NAC men's team and the NCD women's team's presence in the final looks promising. Dini Rose Raiko, National, MTV Sports.
Trukai Sports ends on that note. Up next, the weather details for the next 24 hours.
Trukai Sports. Trukai Sports.
The weather details are proudly brought to you by Dulux Weather Shield. Worth doing with Dulux.
A look at the weather forecast for the next 24 hours in the southern region. Port Moresby, Daru, Kerma, Alota, Papandeta. All these major centres can expect thundery showers. To the Mombasa region, thundery showers expected in Lae, rain and showers in Wau, a shower or two for Medang, Wewak and Vanimore. To the New Guinea Islands region, a shower or two for Lorangau, Kavieng, Kokopo, Rabaul, Kimbe and Buka. And in the Highlands region, Mount Hagen, Goroka, Kundiawa, Mendi and Wabeg, all these major centres can expect some showers with morning fog.
The weather details are proudly brought to you by Dulux Weather Shield. Worth doing with Dulux.
And that has been the news, sports and weather for today, Saturday the 11th of March 2017. On behalf of the news team, pleasant viewing. Good night.